Hello friends, how are you doing? I'm back with my another video, which is one of the most important video as all the topics discussed in this are very important. For easy understanding, I have divided the video into multiple parts, four or five parts. So once we are done with these four or five videos, our first chapter would be over, which contributes around almost 15% of the total syllabus of CWNA. And there would be a combined quiz after these four or five videos for chapter one, which includes all the earlier video as well as these four or five videos, and we would have a combined quiz on the same. So let's start with previous video quiz questions first. Okay. So what RF component is responsible for generating the AC signal? That is a transmitter. The sum of all the components from the transmitter to the antenna, not including the antenna, is known as what? IR or intentional radiator, both are the same thing. Select the absolute units of power. So there are two types of units, absolute and relative units. So absolute units are watt, milliwatt and dBm. Relatives are decibel, dBd, dBi. 23 dBm is equal to how many watt? Milliwatt, 200. I will show you how to calculate it. So first convert to milliwatt, first calculate how many tens and threes are needed to add up to 23. So we know the formula for tens and threes. If your power increased by 10, then it will multiply 10 times to your power. If the power decreases by 3 decibel, then your power become half. So this is a 10 or 3's rule which we discussed. Okay, now following the same rule, so I have divided 0 plus 10 plus 10 plus 3. Now 10 raised to power 1 equal to 10, 10 raised to power 2, because there are 2 2's, so 10 raised to power 2, 100. And then there is a plus 3. So 3 plus 3 means 3 decibel increase, double the power. So it is 200 milliwatt. Okay. So let's start with our today's agenda. So I have done what I have done. As I said, there are multiple videos. So first I have divided a day 5 into multiple 5A and 5B. Okay. In 5A, we will be discussing electromagnetic radiation, polarization, azimuth and elevation charts, beam width. So what is electromagnetic radiation? When electric and magnetic components move, it produces the electric field and magnetic field respectively. So electric field results from voltage changes occurring in the RF antenna, which is radiating the signal, and magnetic changes result from the current. So electromagnetic waves have both electric and magnetic components that are inseparable. The plane of these fields are at right angle. So electric and magnetic fields, which are produced because of RF energy of antenna, they are at perpendicular to each other and to the direction of movement as well, and moving away from antenna. Okay, so let's see what I am trying to explain here. So both fields propagate away from the antenna and each other. Together, both fields create continuous pattern which moves the electromagnetic radiation in the space. So this electromagnetic pattern or fields produces a continuous pattern which help them to move in a space. Okay, so this is electromagnetic radiation pattern. So you can see this is magnetic field, this is electric field. Both are parallel to perpendicular to each other. At the same time, they are perpendicular to the direction of movement. So they are moving in this direction and it's perpendicular to the direction of movement as well, which helps them to continuously move in the space. So this is called electromagnetic radiation. Then next topic is polarization. Polarization, what is polarization? The way or the pattern in which wave oscillates is defined by polarization. So if your wave is vertically oscillating in a vertical perpendicularly, okay, in a perpendicular direction, then to the E field, then it is called a vertical polarized wave. If it is oscillating, if the wave is oscillating in a parallel direction to the earth or earth surface, then it is called a horizontal polarized wave. Okay, so what is polarization? Polarization will tell you the way wave or amplitude of the wave oscillates. So let's see what is polarization and what all types of polarization it is. So it is a property applying to transverse wave that specifies the geometrical orientation of the oscillation. So it's very technical term. In simple words, polarization defines the wave oscillates in the space. So if wave is moving from point A to B, the way it moves or oscillates while moving is known as the polarization. Okay, there are two type of polarization, linear and circular. Further, linear and circle is further divided into two types. Linear is divided into vertical or horizontal polarization, and circular is divided into right hand circular, left hand circular. Let me show you through simulator how these waves oscillates in the space. So this is very first is an example of vertical polarized wave. So what is vertical polarized wave? When its electric field, when the electric field of a wave is perpendicular to the earth surface, then it is called vertical polarized wave. Okay. Now let's see horizontal. When electric field of the wave is parallel to the earth surface, then it is called horizontal polarized wave. So this is a linear polarization, and the major polarization used in the system is linear one only. Very rarely circular polarization is used. Okay, now let's see circular one. So as I said, there are two types of circular polarized wave, left and right circular. If the rotation is clockwise, let me show you. If the rotation is clockwise, looking in the direction of propagation. So here, wave is moving clockwise and moving in this direction, then it is called right hand circular polarization. Okay, if the wave is moving in anti-clockwise direction, while moving towards propagating in the space, then it is called left hand circular polarization. So I hope you are clear with the concept of this polarization. Okay, so why it is important? So it is important that polarization of antennas at both ends of the path use the same polarization method. If it is using a different polarization scheme at both ends, then misalignment of polarization results into a signal attenuation. So 45 degree misalignment result into up to 3 decibel of signal attenuation. 90 degree of mismatch result up to 20 decibel of attenuation. Okay, so it is highly recommended both ends of the system or both ends of the communication points A and B, both endpoints should communicate using the same polarization method. So while deploying your setup or while implementation, it is very much important to survey or understand the client requirements and understand what type of client is going to attach to this particular antennas, then place antennas according to that polarization only. Okay, so vertical polarization is when it is desired to radiate a single signal in all direction, such as widely distributed mobile unit. So vertical polarization is used in that, in particularly that scenarios. Horizontal is used in television broadcasts. Then circular is used in satellite communication. So this is just a one use case examples, but they all can be used in each type of environment, but it depends what is your end user who are going to use that service. So it depends totally upon the clients, what type of clients are going to be use that service. So plan your implementation according to them. Okay. Then after this, what we have discussed now, this is a more or a physics terms as a polarization, electromagnetic radiation. So now we will discuss azimuth and elevation charts. So what is azimuth and elevation chart and why it is important? So when you like for I'm taking an analogy of lamp, like you went into the market, you want to purchase a lamp, you went into the showroom, there are two or three lamps available there. You switch on the lamp, you will saw the light emitting pattern of each of these lamp. So as per your requirement, you select one. It is very easy to purchase a lamp on the basis of their emitting pattern. But in case of antenna, it is not that easy. It is not even easy. It is very tedious task because there are, you would not be able to identify the antenna radiation pattern by just switching on the antenna. So you have RF meter, you have to be calculate the RF energy at various levels, then only you would be able to decide what is the radiation pattern of this particular antenna is. So which is technically not possible to check each and every type of antenna. So to assist potential buyers, OEMs, manufacturers come up with the azimuth and elevation charts, which shows the approximate radiation pattern of that particular antenna. So using that radiation pattern, you would be able to select the antenna as per your requirement. Okay. So again, as I said, to assist potential buyer with their purchasing decision, OEMs comes with azimuth and elevation chart, which are commonly represent the radiation pattern. Azimuth chart, it shows the top down view of the radiation pattern of the antenna and label as H plane. So it shows the top down view of the radiation pattern of the antenna and labeled as H plane. Okay, so example is this. So this is omnidirectional antenna azimuth chart. So it has a 360 degree of coverage. Okay, so this is the omnidirectional. So this show top down view with the 360 degree coverage. Elevation chart shows the side view of the radiation pattern of the antenna and labeled as E plane. So this is a elevation chart of the omnidirectional antenna. These charts are commonly known as polar charts or antenna radiation envelopes. Okay, so we will use these polar charts in calculating beam width. So and then beam width is further used for deciding your antenna. So these are very important, and the outer ring of the chart represents the strongest signal of the antenna. Okay. One more important thing, this chart doesn't represent distance or any level of power or strength. It only represents the relationship of power between different points. So what I mean to say with this word, I will explain you in the coming slide, where we will discuss about beam width, how beam width is calculated. Okay, then you would be able to understand that these charts does not represent any distance or any level of power or strength with this distance. Okay, let's have a look at the beam width. So what is beam width? So beam width is the measurement of how broad or narrow the focus of antenna is. So when I purchase one antenna, I would like to know that how farther this antenna can go and how much broader it can serve the subscriber. So that could be calculated through a beam width. So beam width is the measurement of how broad or narrow the focus of an antenna is and is measured both horizontally and vertically. So if the beam width is narrow, definitely it will go farther. If beam width is broader, definitely it will not go that much far. Okay, so it is the measurement from the center or the strongest point of the antenna to each of the point along the horizontal axis where signal decreases by half power. So as I said in previous slide, the strongest point is the outer ring of the chart represents the strongest point. So it is the measurement from the outer ring to the point along the horizontal axis where signal decreases by half power. So we discussed in our last video with the 3 dB decrease in gain, power decreases by half. Okay, so in it actually it it is explaining that from the outer ring where the signal decreases by 3 decibel, beam width is measured from that point. That is called half power beam width. Okay. So beam width is measured in degrees at point where the main lobe decreases by 3 decibel. So what is main lobe? What is side lobe? I will explain when we in next slide when I will when we will calculate beam width. Beam width is very important to understand the radiating pattern of the antenna, as majority of the antenna energy is focused within the beam width only. Okay, very much important to calculate. Actually, this beam width is called half power beam width. Okay, and it is important because half power beam width tend to be closely reflected to the gain of the antenna. So it reflects the gain of the antenna, actual gain of the antenna. So it's very important and very significant when you are selecting an antenna or when you are implementing some system somewhere. Okay, so it's very much important. So how to calculate beam width? So we discussed technical terms, but actually these technical terms you would be able to correlate it when I will discuss and explain how to calculate beam width and what I'm trying to say in these technical terms. First, determine the scale of the polar chart. Polar charts are azimuth and elevation charts. So scale is minus 30 decibel, then minus 20, minus 10, 0. So this solid line represents that inner cycle circle has a minus 30 decibel gain. Here it has the maximum gain. As I said, outer ring represents the strongest signal. Okay, then these dotted lines represent minus 5, minus 15, minus 25 decibels. Okay, the complete chart looks like as below. This is a complete chart, and in this complete chart this is a radiating pattern. So you don't worry about this chart, how this chart comes to me, and don't think it's something technical I have created by my own self. So this is the azimuth and elevation chart provided by OEM. The chart will be provided by the manufacturer. You have to be calculate beam width on that chart, or more or less beam width is also provided by OEM, but for your technical understanding you should know how to calculate beam width. So in this radiation pattern, this is the main lobe. So main lobe is the lobe where most of the energy of the antenna is focused, and these are the side lobes, and this is a back lobe. Side lobes are lobes which generated because when you focus your antenna gain in some direction, it is not 100% focused in that direction only. It radiates energy out of that focus as well, so it creates a side lobe. So if the side lobes are smaller, it's okay, but if there are excessive side lobes, then it will create it will waste the energy as well as cause the interference. So try to focus energy more and more, then so that you should have a very small side lobes. Side lobes are these lobes and back lobes. Okay, now how to calculate, let's proceed on this. To determine the beam width of this antenna, first locate the point on the chart where the antenna signal is the strongest. So as I said, outer ring represents the strongest signal. So this is the strongest signal point. Why this is? Why not here? Why not there? Because this whole complete circle represents the strongest signal. Okay. But this strongest signal is here. Why? Because the main lobe is focused towards this direction, and at this direction only the beam main lobe is focused. So this is the strongest point only. So only this point is the strongest. Okay. Now, as we discussed, when you move away from the strongest point towards the horizontal axis till the point where minus 3 decibel or half the power is decreased. Okay. That point shows your beam width. So from here, I move toward this direction. I move toward this direction. And here, around somewhere here, it's minus 5 here. So somewhere here it's minus 3 decibels. So horizontal axis will intersect here and here. Let's see. So instead of minus 5 decibel, what I have represented, minus 3 decibel circle I have presented. So when you move away from strongest point, this at this point and this point, it vertically, it intersects this. So from this point to till center, and from this point to till this center, you will draw a one line. Okay. So draw a line from each of these points to the middle of the polar chart. So you have drawn this middle of the polar chart. This angle is called beam width or your coverage. So this will give you a beam width of your. So here it's approximately 20 degree. Okay. So see, this is how you will calculate a beam width. And this is very important because beam width gives you the gives the gain of that antenna in particular direction, and very much important while calculating the pattern of radiation pattern of antenna, while deciding which type of antenna to be used for this type of service. So you can easily determine beam width from the azimuth and elevation charts or polar charts. Okay, so friends, we are done with the today's session. So in the next session, we will discuss regarding that with respect to the antennas, types of antennas, and what are the features, and what are the benefits of each type of antenna. So please, so friends, thanks for today. Please don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and comment on my video. Okay, thank you.